So I want to start with asking you about returning to dancing. It was so beautiful to see those two solos and to see you move and to see you back on stage. Can you talk a little bit about your choice to come back dancing?
Sure. My body's telling me right now it was a foolish choice.
I couldn't tell that. It was to us, it was a very smart choice.
I don't know. You know, I stopped dancing for about 8 years and just created work from the outside. And I missed being an intuitive physical presence inside the work, just as I think dancers have that in their body and their spirit, particularly if you're creating. A few years ago, I was given a commission by the American Dance Festival to create a new solo as part of an evening of four male choreographers. And I took up the challenge and returned to the stage after about 8 years, created a piece entitled The Fabulist, which put myself back in the center of the physicality of my work, and I had forgotten what that felt like. It's very different when you create work for someone and hand it over to them and step back and allow them to live in it, and it's very different when it actually emanates from your pores. So I've been dancing The Fabulous for a bit, and when we decided to put this program together, I kind of looked at the timeline and realized it had been 30 years since I created, almost to the day that I created Nocturne, and Pam and I had a discussion about the creation of a new work, and I thought it would be really fascinating to see these two ideas side by side and to understand, for myself at least, the trajectory that my movement vocabulary has taken and the choreographic career.
So I saw the concert on Wednesday night, and I saw it again tonight. The way the two solos worked tonight was different. I think when I think about one solo ends, and then you do a bit of a circle, and I thought 30 years in that circle, and I felt like I digested that tonight. That was like time, and then you move into where you were. It's very, very moving.
Thank you. I'm finding that... That transition, there was a very different opening when I first created the second solo, and it wasn't until I started putting them together that I realized that I didn't need it.
So I want to steal an idea of Pamela Taji's that she put in my head. She said that there was something about you doing the solos that it's almost like you're sort of laying the groundwork for us to perceive and take in the rest of the evening, and I felt that so clearly tonight. It's like your the Varone-ness is in the air. You put it in the air, and then your dances come on, and we've already tasted it. Were you thinking that way about it, or just something that we just came up with over here at the pillow?
I think it's beautiful. I put it first on the program because I knew if I put it later on the program, I'm not sure I would have shown up. But there is something there's something beautiful about just walking onto a stark stage,
yeah,
and painting.
Yeah.
And I feel like when I walked into the studio for the first time to create Nocturne in 1987, I didn't have a thought in my head. I knew I had movement vocabulary, and it really was about exploring. It very much felt like an artist in a bare space trying ideas out. Mm.
So I wanna talk about Boats Leaving. It's such a beautiful and moving work. If for those of you who didn't go to the pre-show talk, the story of how it came to be of the photographs from the New York Times is to me really interesting. Can you say a little bit about how this work sort of bubbled up?
Sure. You know, you get to a place in a creative cycle where you feel like you have played all your cards out. And I felt as an artist, right before I created Boats Leaving, that I was in that place. And I was really struggling to figure out how to create again. It was a very, very difficult time for me. I just wasn't sure I had anything else to say. So I when I went into the studio to begin the process of creating Boats Leaving, I really just walked into, I didn't even change. I walked into the studio, I sat in the chair, the company was in front of me, and I had the New York Times with me. And I literally just, I started opening up the pages, and I started looking at the photographs on them. The front page, some of the cartoons, the sports section, the arts and leisure section, anything that looked like it had a really interesting architectural or emotional texture to it, we tried recreating. And I think we had about 60 or 80 of them to start with. And they were random. From all different areas of life. Once I started putting them together, a palette started kind of forming in front of my eyes, and I had a sense of where I could go with the dance. And it revitalized me as an artist in many ways. I jokingly say that Boats Leaving saved my life in a way, because it retaught me the value of staying true to who you are and constantly continue to search for what you believe in.
What great advice to any artist out there that at a time where you were struggling creatively, you end up creating a work with incredible power and staying power. And it's still, the boats are still leaving.
They are. And yeah. I think the potency of it is that it, in many ways it was reflective of my life at the time.
Yeah, yeah. The photographs, the tableaus, those little moments, they also, for me, embed the piece with lives lived. Like this, like it's just they're right, like a ghostly presence, and I think it gives the piece its power. Can you talk about the ending of Boats Leaving?
I find if I were to be as open as possible, I would say that throughout our lives, people leave. Whether they pass or whether they leave your life, it's constantly happening. It happens daily. So for me, just the simplicity of that visual vibrates for me. So we tried to keep it as simple as possible. In many ways, we foreshadow it by constantly forming these lines, and certainly to that angle, so that it sets up something that almost feels inevitable.
Right. Let's move to a happier place and talk about ReComposed. Mm-hmm. So in preparation for talking about your work, I hauled up in the Museum of Fine Arts Houston Library to look at a whole lot of Joan Mitchell's work, and it was like, these really do look like Doug Varone dances. Like, wow, he is really.
Were there pastels there?
Yes.
They're amazing. They're so incredible.
So it was so rich. But how did you stumble into her work? And
I had known Joan Mitchell's paintings for many, many years, but mostly her oils. Mm-hmm. I wasn't aware of her pastels. And I was walking in the Chelsea section of New York, which has all these galleries, and there was a show of her pastels, and I walked in and I started looking at them, and I thought, my goodness, they're just the sheer complicatedness and the chaos in there, but there was like structure underneath, and I thought, these look like my group dances.
Yeah, the density of
absolutely.
Them, the density and the tangled lines and. Yeah.
So I started doing a lot of research, and I reached out to the Joan Mitchell Foundation. They were really, really helpful in terms of giving me access to certain tools, and decided I would use. I've never used another artist's work as inspiration before, and decided I would step into that and see if I could create a Varone piece based off of what I was seeing. So we actively used a lot of the. A lot of the pastels to create, playing games with the dancers, figuring out how to create movement motifs based off of line and shape, and then threw the pastels away so that it was just the work itself. So there was never that sense of feeling scripted to something. Right. but allowing the work to constantly breathe anew.
And so when did Michael Gordon's score come into the process?
Well, I you know, in terms of doing a lot of research on Mitchell, she actually painted to music, which was fascinating. So she painted a Mozart, she painted a Billie Holiday, she loved Ornette Coleman, Mozart. So I thought, well, this is going to be great. I'm just going to bring all these pieces of music in, and I'm just, you know, I'm going to play all these, and we're going to come up with some, you know, pastiche, and none of it worked. And I I started then kind of looking out past that source material, and was familiar. I know Dave, I know Michael well from using other scores, and had come across this one particular score and another one of his that we were jumping back and forth on. And then I realized that the pure cacophony of dystopia, yeah. And also it takes you to so many different palettes,
yeah.
That I felt it had a rightness to it in terms of her work and in terms of mine.
How do you create that beautiful chaos on stage?
Okay. When I was a kid, I used to lock myself in the bathroom, and I used to take out all of my mom's lipstick canisters. And I don't know why, you know, I look back on it now, she must have had like 50, or like, I don't know, it seemed like so many when I was a kid. But and they were all like, you know, sort of different sizes, and I would move them around like they were people. And I would build these little, you know, scenes, tragic scenes, you know, pretending that they were little people, and I would move them and, you know, throw them to the floor and then pick them up, and I realized that was kind of my first choreographic experience. I have always had a sense of seeing space constantly divide itself and reimagining it. Very often when I'm building something that is chaotic, I start with one body, and I add a second, and I add a third, and I add a fourth, so I'm constantly adding to the mix and leaving holes, because I know that when I get to the eighth person, I'm going to want to move that person through those holes. So it kind of becomes a little bit like knitting and weaving. I play a lot of creative games with the company to build material. A lot of that material ends up being used within the work. Some of it's built in a very complex way, so it's very much about kind of taking that organism and placing it within the framework of the piece. But I get a charge out of building complicated patterns in space. Mm. It kind of soothes me a little bit.
I'm gonna segue into something from what you just said about these bodies, these amazing bodies of your dancers. I can't begin to tell you how beautiful they are to watch, each of them. They have your style, they have their own style. And so you're seeing, you know, ideas, but ideas that are you know, sort of brought into more nuance. What do you look for in a dancer? Because they're just extraordinary. I had a lovely visit with a few of them this afternoon, and they're just wonderful to talk to, Sue. And they just have such a, I can feel by the way they talk about your work that they're just fully inhabiting it.
Great, thank you. I really believe in the individual within each dancer. It's really, really important for me to honor that. I don't like cookie cutter dancers. Everyone looks the same. And I love that you said everyone, that they understand a style, but they all inhabit it in a different way. And I embrace that. You know, if you were to see a unison on stage, they would all look the same. But if you were to actually look at each one individually, they would be doing it slightly differently, and that's beautiful for me. I look for dancers who are really smart. I move very, very quickly in my creative process, and I love to have dancers that can stay with me. I look for dancers that are musical. I look for dancers that are tremendously nice people, because we work a great deal, we tour a great deal, and we are a family in many, many ways. I look for dancers that have information that I don't have, because it allows the palette of creativity to be larger. So I hold auditions sometimes. Very often I find dancers through workshops that we hold. If I'm not looking for anyone at the moment, I will always stay in touch with people that I'm interested in and bring them into the fray when I feel that it's the time is right.